Welcome to Future Talk. On today's program, we're going to talk about literacy in the age of Google. At a time when most of the world's information is on the internet and can be readily accessed through search engines such as Google, how many people really know how to use these search engines effectively and get the most out of them? Here to answer that question and show us how to better utilize these tools is my guest, Daniel Russell. Daniel is a research scientist at Google, where he studies how people search for and organize information and then turns that knowledge into better search quality and greater user satisfaction. He has a PhD in computer science from the University of Rochester in New York and specialized in artificial intelligence until he realized that his real passion was understanding human intelligence. He worked at Xerox PARC, which originated the graphical user interface for personal computers. He was in the advanced technology group at Apple, where he wrote the first 100 pages for the Apple website, and he recently created a MOOC, or Massive Open Online Course, called Power Searching with Google, which had over 150,000 registered students. Dan, welcome to the program.
Great. It's great to be here, Marty. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. Now, when we talk about literacy in the age of Google, what are we talking about? Are we redefining the whole concept of literacy?
Well, if you think about literacy, it's kind of this old idea that's been around, and the traditional dictionary definition would be something like the ability to read and write. Well, what does that mean in the age when everything is digital, when everything is online? Can you read and write video? We are here, but can most people do that? Or what does it mean for them to read and write all the different kinds of media? So I do think it's time to be reassessing what it means to be literate. In the age of Google, when you can reach out and contact hundreds of millions of results, what does it mean to be able to find something in a single book? I think it's different.
Is it harder to be literate in the age of Google? Does it require more on the part of the user than just reading books?
Well, this is what I dream, right? Is that being literate now means that you have a deeper understanding of what the content is. So in essence, it's really kind of a thinking about what it means to think critically about stuff. Because you know people will go onto the internet, do a simple search, get back the first result, and it's total nonsense. How do we get people out of that sort of mode of thinking and thinking more deeply in more interesting ways about the material they do find?
Now, you spend a lot of time studying Google users to find out how they do their searches and how they organize their information. What have you found? Have you found anything unexpected in the way people use it?
My job is really to understand how people use Google and the kinds of ways they use and misuse that information that they do get. So my job is one unending series of surprises. It's really interesting to watch people as they use Google because they'll do things that seem silly, right? They will do queries that are ostensibly on topic, but are really wacky and way off topic. And so that's the first thing that surprises me.
I mean, people use Google just for fun. Like sometimes I'll be on my computer and I'll have the television on and I'll hear a name on the TV that I don't know, so I'll just look it up right then and there.
I think that that's fine. It's completely appropriate, I think, to use Google for fun. But what I'll see is people not necessarily typing in the person's name, but they'll type in something sort of way off topic. So a story I tell is about watching a sixth grade kid trying to write a report about the Costa Rican ecosystem. And his query was sweaty clothes. And it's true when you're in the jungle, you get sweaty clothes, but that's not a great way to find out about the jungle. So that's what I mean by having sort of mismatched queries that don't match the query intent. That is what you're trying to find out.
So you need some sophistication about how to word your query.
You know, sophistication is calling it too much. It's just making a kind of clear sense out of your information intent. So if you're trying to, for example, find out something about Costa Rica, say Costa Rica. That seems obvious.
I would think so.
You would think, but I've seen people, time and again, not include sort of really salient keywords in their query. And that's kind of crazy.
Now, is Google something you have to learn how to use? Most people who use computers probably think they know how to use Google. They enter a search string and that's it. But I gather that to use the full power of it, you need to do something more than that.
Right. Well, Google, I think, like a lot of high technology, suffers from the Lake Wobegon effect. Everybody thinks they're better than average. So what I find, actually, is that people kind of plateau out. They start using Google, they learn one or two tricks, and that's it. That's the end of their learning experience. But in fact, there's a whole lot more power there if you could only spend a few seconds to learn how to do it or experiment. So it's a little bit like having Formula One race car drivers teaching the mechanics how to drive. Sure, everybody, any mechanic can drive a car, but they may not be able to get that Formula One around that race course at that high speed. So it's a little bit of skill, but it's not hard.
Now, you do a lot of lecturing on this topic, and you have a slideshow, which takes about an hour and a half under normal circumstances, but I think you brought a few of your slides with you. Maybe we could take a look at some of your slides and you can explain them. That might be better than just talking about it.
That'd be fine. Let me show you a couple of slides to get started. So I usually start out my talk by giving an example of the old technology. So this is the old technology. And when I was a kid, when you were a kid, we would go off and learn the information access procedures for this technology. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, what this meant is this is a giant compendium. This is actually a collection of codices. Right. And here's another way to think about it, another kind of document. This is the Reader's Guide to Periodical Literature.
Which is an index of everything ever written, pretty much.
In the magazines and journals, right? As opposed to the libraries. And so what you see down there on the right is that sort of, that's a periodic update that they would do. They would send out new books and append them to the end. So to actually look through the last, say, 5 years meant going to five different sections, maybe 10, depending on how often it was updated. So when technology changes, a fundamental thing happens. The way we use that technology changes. And so this cartoon captures, I think, the essence of this very nicely. When you think about the access time to get the information in the library, it may take you a long time. It may take you minutes, maybe hours. Google, pre-Google, the world was different. You got stuck, what would you do? Well, you wouldn't go to the library. Now you pull out that tablet, like you were saying, pull out the tablet, pull out your phone, pull out your laptop, and you would search for it.
So it's all at our fingertips now. It makes it a lot easier.
That's right. It's at your fingertips, and it's rapid to access. So we're talking on the order of seconds to find out a question, the answer to a question. So here's that the same Google result for that query we were looking at earlier with the Reader's Guide to Periodical Literature. This is that same query for high technology industries. And what we've got here are, what, 216 million results. That's better than the 12 results we saw in the book. So what I really wanted to try to get across in my talk is this idea of informacy. Now, literacy, if you think about it, is talking about to be literate means to talk about texts. Informacy is being literate about information. And so information is this bigger, more sort of a malleable concept.
So does if you that mean that you don't have to know anything, you just have to know where to find it when you want it?
Well, you have to know a little bit about that when you're using a traditional library, too. You have to know what sections there are and so on. So what I mean by informacy is that you know what information is and how you can combine it. Because one of the great things about being on the internet and using a search engine like Google is that you can pull pieces from many different locations and pull them together and build something larger than just individual answers that you might think of. So the notion of informacy is really doing something like this. So here's a large page, the 10K results from a recent race. Now, if you ask someone to find out how long it took this person to run in the race.
She's presumably on that list.
Trust me, she's on that list. And I've asked a lot of people to find out how long it takes, how long it took her to run that race. And people who know how to use the Control F trick, you know the Control F trick?
To find something.
To find something, yeah. Control F, you type Control F and you type Beth Assange or just the last name. And it jumps immediately to that point down in the document. And if you know that trick, it takes 2, maybe 3 seconds to find how long it took. If you don't know that trick, average is 12 minutes. 12 minutes. That's crazy. Or, in the worst case, people never find it at all because they're going line by line. But that's a kind of informant skill. See what I mean? If you know how to use Command F or Control F or Edit Find, you read documents differently.